have my fairy wand. I made a fairy wand, and my reason, because I'm out here, I'm doing this singing, and I'm like, well, I have these really light songs to sing, and they're so light, oh my god, if maybe the fairy wand will help, you know, so, you know, it does. And then I saw that I'm lightening my voice, it's getting lighter and lighter, then the machine just doesn't like it still, it's still doesn't understand my words, so I have to still work on the diction of that. That's anyway. So yeah, so it's a fun, I don't know, like my singing baton. So it is working for me. It has a lot of power. It's made with glass. It has all those little glass, what do you call it, glass beads. And then I just use regular, like, Mod Podge and then the spray glue. And then pearl on the end. But anyway, yeah. So I don't know, I'm not really having, like, much going on at the moment, except these three arias that are just torture for me, and that's the my bell, the F my bell glier, and the first part of the glier, the long zom section, and then later is the I can sing them, I think they sound fine, but the machine turns them into torture words. I'm like, no, I didn't say that, and there it is, you know. And Rue Sanft, and I thought I had that one, and it's another torture, so I don't know, I'm not getting the clarity. And so it gets like this, and then it throws in the wrong word at the wrong time. And it's hot lately. I think it's in the 90s. Luckily there's fans in this house, my gosh. Luckily, but so many hoots. What was I doing? Oh, I came up with a great idea. I don't know if it's great. Probably already been came up with before. It was about for dancers, the retired ones, so they could go out on the stage once a year, at least once a year, like a fun thing to do for the dancers that are retired, 40 or older. I mean, really retired. You can be a secretary now, I don't care. But, you know, put on a little costume and then get out there on the Aftenbühne, and you get out there, and then you have a performance with, we just play like a set music, like a Sleeping Beauty CD, and then we have all of the older dancers doing their thing. And you all have your little tiny space or whatever. So it's an idea, isn't it? It's an idea. And then I thought, well, you can make it like a chain, like city to city to city to city. So if you danced in the Paris Opera, was my example, then the Paris Opera Dream Company, Rêve Compagnie, that would be, is that right? Compagnie? No, Compagnie. I don't even know. But anyway, so you take that, all of those dancers that were retired, and they go back once a year, and they make they're included in the performance if they want. And then fun for the audience too, because it's just like, wow, that one came back and did something. And they don't have to do tricks or anything. It's just the point that they go out on stage, and you get to see them move again. It's kind of interesting. Ay. So, because who was it? It was Nureyev I saw, and I believe it was like one of his last years that he ever danced. Maybe it was one of his last performances in Germany. And it was very interesting. Yeah, he still held himself, his composure of dancer, amazing. And he was quite a fellow, and the what do we call it, the eye contact during the whole performance. He was looking at me, and I was like, well, okay, we'll have a stare at, but I was in the audience, I was in the front, And so it's kind of funny. It's kind of funny that he was giving eye contacts. Hello. Yeah. But yeah, I didn't expect that. It was outdoor. It was an outdoor production. And that was nice. It was in a garden. It was him in a garden. And he had a really young talents there, you know, from Paris, over, really young ones. And, you know, they're gorgeous little bodies. And he was there in his own unitard there. Not lilt at all, just an older fellow. And it was funny. At first, I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, he's too gordito to be dancing. But after a while, I'm like, no, he's still there. His presence is still there. And I just watched him, and I didn't want to watch the others with their beautiful lilt bodies. So it was very interesting. With all of their technique and all of their consumption power of creating their gorgeous bodies, he was more interesting for me to look at and watch. He was much more clever in his, what do you call it, his prowess. He still had quite a prowess. So, and they did not, even though they were beautiful. So that was what I saw. Anyway, where was it? So I'm talking about this, the chain de rêve, yeah, the dream companies. So any ballet company you're ever in, you would go to that town once a year when they had the performance, and you would be welcome to dance on their stage with the others. And so it could be crowded as heck on that stage, or it could just be like, well, not many this year, you know. So we have a lot of soloists here. Everybody's a soloist, and there's gaps, and we need more people. Yeah, so it could be that in some places, but I have a feeling, I mean, because we're talking anybody 40 or older, you could be 80 years old out there, you know. You could be 80 years old just taking a beautiful walk across the stage, and that would be your moment, and that's fine. And these types of productions, aside from what? Good heavens. Aside from just being memory productions, they're fun also. They're eccentric. And so they're laughable, and the dancers can wear any costume they want, make their own funny costume. So it would be like a joy show rather than a serious, be more of a parody, is the word, yeah, parody, more than a serious, because parody will exist. There will be serious, if you want to be serious, you could, you know, as the dancer, you could be the serious one there, amongst the parody that will exist. Because, you know, when the bodies do start to become all different shapes, it is a laugh. Anyway, so what's the deal? Yeah, I think I've been beaten by this programming of the recording of these arias. I've gotten so far, and it's beaten me. I'm done. I can't make it work. So I'm kind of upset with them, and because they're tough ones, and I thought I had them. Dang it. Anyway, I may have been repeating myself, I don't know. What is this, the repetition show? Maybe that's what it is, yeah. Anyway, so I really made this cheaply and quickly just by throwing it on the glue. I know you were really curious. Throwing it on the glue rather than one-for-one wrapping. But in the future, I believe I will do a full-on, if I had a string wrap all the way around. It'll be nicer on the hands to touch. This is a little bit ornery. So anywho, what else do I have to say? Not much. Not even sure why I'm doing this video. That's a strange color it put out on me. I don't get it. Turn another hue. There. There's that hue. Good gosh. It's getting me all red around here. It's blotchy. Eek. I don't know. So, what are we on this? Is there anything else I have? That was my only money-making idea. And then I was talking about love, and I was the quality of the what it means, the quality of love, and love itself, and the reminder of love being there on the stage. The stage environment is where love is enacted. It's brought there. The people engage in the dance of love all the time. And when they're out there in the dances of love, then out there in the audience, there they are. There's the audience sitting there, and they watch it. You know, they're just watching it. So in a way, the dancers are teachers, love teachers. So we teach them that this is what love is. These are love representations. You know what I mean? And because it's a love representation moment, it's like, whoa. And also, it's important. It's important that it not be farced or fake. It's important that it has a trueness. You know what I mean? Because where are they getting that reinforcement of what love is? You know, we've been dancing for years and years, centuries and centuries and centuries. We've been dancing, tribal dancing. This type of dancing, that type of dancing. We've been dancing, and that's always been a love expression. And so many people don't dance. They don't even try. They don't even attempt. You know. So, are they different? Like, are they different people? Are they different, like, in their brain? You know, you take the dancer who dances, and then you take the person who's never danced. You know. Their brains must be different. They must have different facets, you know what I mean? Of understanding, and maybe they're not on the same compassion scale. Maybe they're just not on the same compassion. I often think that the outsiders of dance are just compassionate people. They're kind of how should I say it? Scolding in their selves, in their lifestyle. And the more I don't dance, I drift into that. You know, I drift into that type of self. And I'm like, no, I don't want to be that scolding self. You know, they become these scolders. Of society. I'm not to say that dancers are not scolders, they're scolders also. But I believe more so you have that group out there that they're not even in touch with, you know. There's just some that are just not in touch with the emotional factor of love. They're not in touch with the emotional factor of themselves, you know. They just are ruled by, you know, they're ruled by, and that's their direction. They're given their set of rules, and then they walk that way, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So then I had a revelation, because there was the mention of, there's the dance of the chains of love, or whatever, the chains on the head. And yeah, the chains, you know, you have the chains of love. And that just made me like, that's so heavy, that's too heavy, the chains of love. So I went with the chains of the mountains. Yes, so because we are the chains of the mountains, that's more elemental. That's more like back to the planet. We are the soil, we are the salt, we are the elements, you know, all of those things. You know, our body, you take our bodies and you filter us down, and we turn into a little pile. of elements. You know, we are a mountain. You know, so each one of us. So when we're looking at the chain of love, we can look at ourselves as a chain of a mountain, you know, the mountain chain. And then that, from there, I'm like, well, that's interesting, because if I'm a mountain, now I start looking at the other mountains. I'm like, well, that mountain has been over manicured. You know, you see the man who has been, like, I don't know, totally done up, you know, he's really manicured. And you see his mountain, and you already know he has, like, little tiny paved streets, and he lives in, like, Tiburon somewhere, Sausalito. Yeah, really manicured type of environment, manicured self. But that would be his mountain, the very, very adorned and treated as, pedicured and everything. So very much so, with lots of gardeners on his mountain. Whereas you have other people, and they're more wild. Their mountain self is more wild, you know. They have bears running around and antelopes, you know. They're just more wild and free with themselves, you know, more freedom of spirit, more free nature types. One's filled with less vanity on those mountains, in their range, you know what I mean. So we have this one that is just really manicured and pedicured and like requiring purchase and dealings with lots of human beings and you know, to make his mountain just right, the mountain of his self, you know, where he lives, what he drives. That type of person is really in that vanity circle, you know, that vanity self. So his mountain is something that when you go to it, if you were going to be there, I don't think you can really roller skate. I don't think so. I think you would have maybe special pathways you could walk. But no, I don't believe roller skates. I think that would be too loud. So I get the feeling that type of person will have a quiet mountain self, but not with loud bicycles and roller skates, anything like that. Maybe walking. You could walk, you know, take nature trails, only on the nature trails. So, now these other mountain selves, now I have this other mountain self, and these other ones, this other one I was saying was wild, a wild mountain. You could just walk anywhere on that mountain, there are no trails. So you understand the difference, nothing manicured. And that when I'm thinking even of the animals there, it would be wild animals. Yeah, so we are all these different types of people, obviously. Yeah. I'm still trying to figure out my own mountain range, what it is. Because you can't really go with where you live and how that is your forced mountain. You know, it doesn't force you. Just because you live in a certain environment doesn't force you into that self. You know what I mean? That just because you live in a tight little neighborhood with lots of little houses, it doesn't force you to be that type of a mountain self. You could be a different type of mountain self. You know what I mean? So anyway, it's a different type of way of looking at. Yeah, different way of looking at it. And in a way, the mountain selves, when we find ourselves even talking or thinking about it, it's a real isolate, isn't it? It's a very isolate, because it's just like, wait a minute, I really am alone, you know? And I know that aloneness, and I'm fine with it. And yet, I know of the other mountains, you know what I mean? I know of those other mountains around. And that's, in a way, you can't get rid of those other mountains around. They are there to stay. They're not going to change. You know, in your life, you know, as you go through less and less, they're going to change less and less. You know, that mountain is pretty much gonna be molded, you know, more and more, the older it gets, molded to its mountain self. And yeah, so there, that person is structured as they have committed themselves to be structured, you know, throughout their life. Yeah. Here I am running back to fairy wands. Yeah, I did when I was in Ulm. I was an absolute nutter. I used to go through in the mornings, and I bugged those dancers. I used to fairy wand them to wake up every morning, and oh, they would growl at me. They would growl at me. Some of them, and some of them were so happy they got fairy wanded. I don't understand it. But yeah, some were happy and others would growl, you know, like, oh, she's such a pest, you know, I don't want to be fairy wanted, get out of here, my life is so amazing and decadent that I don't need a fairy nearby me, you know, yeah. But it was something I did, and you know, that type of a self, that's on my mountain and I can't change it, you know, it's my personality. And yet, I have waned away from that, you know what I mean? I waned away from it, from being that open. I used to be that open as a human being, you know? Scary too, some of those dancers were scary and mean, you know? Scary and mean and competitive, you know? How dare she come near me with her fairy wand? I don't know. And so then I'm like, well, then the next year I did not fairy wand anybody. You know, and so they started to chip away at my mountain self. That was my direction. They started to chip away with their strict, their rigid philosophy of their mountain self, you know. They have to be so cool and suave. All of that, you know, they got at me, you know, they got at my innocence, didn't they? So anyway, so I said, forget it, after all these years, and I made my fairy wand. Forget them and all of their upper snuff, that's who they are, they're just a bunch of upper snuffs. I can't believe it. And then I even tried to like say hello, be my friend on that Facebook, and they did not friend me back. I'm like, well, screw you, just screw you. I cannot believe it. After all the stage I was on with you and all of the costume changes, and I had to look at your tits, I you won't friend me back? I mean, my God, just sickening. Anyway, so yeah, I'm a little bit like, what's that word, miffed? I'm miffed at a group with their overdone, cool. Well, their innocence is long gone, long gone. Okay, guys. Oh, that's funny. It's almost like a cigarette you could smoke at that. Don't smoke. Really, it's bad for you.